Welcome to part 6 of this 12-part Python tutorial series for beginners. Congratulations if you made it this far because you're halfway through. In this chapter, we're going to learn about loops in Python. Loops are a way of repeating the execution of our code. There's several reasons for why we might want to do this, and there's also several different ways we can do it. For example, we can repeat for a fixed number of times, like counting to 100. Or if we have a list of items, we can go through each item and do something with it, like calculating the total checkout price of a shopping cart. Or we could also just keep repeating a loop forever as long as a certain condition is true. Like if we're making a game, we can run the code in a loop until the player decides to quit. Now that you know how to work with list and individual items in a list, let's look at how a loop would be useful in working with a list. So suppose we have a list and we wanted to do something with all of the items in the list. Or if we wanted to work out the overall price total of items in the shopping cart. In either case, we would need a way to go through each of the items one by one so that we can do something with each of the items, whether that's just summing up a transaction amount or calculating the odds of those poker cards in your hand. In programming, the general concept of going through something step by step is called iteration, and we can use a loop to iterate through the items in a list. Here's an example of how we can write a for loop in Python. So take a good look at this and see if you can understand what it means. And now we're going to go to our code editor and actually write it ourselves just to get some hands-on experience with it. So here I am in my editor, and I have a list of fruits. And again, I'm using emojis instead of writing the actual words because I think it just makes the learning a little bit more visual. And so let's write our first loop. We'll start by writing the keyword for, and then I'm going to write fruit in fruit basket. And here I'm inside the scope of the loop. So you see how my cursor's indented now? That's saying that I'm in the scope of this loop. So whatever I write here is going to be part of this loop. And I'm not going to do anything too complex. I'm just going to print it out. So I'm going to print out the name of the fruit. Okay, so let's give that a go and see what happens. And when I run it, you'll see that this print statement is executed 3 times. And each time, the fruit is a different fruit. So it's the apple, it's the banana, and then it's the berry. Okay, so this works. Now let's just break it down step by step and see what we actually did. What this basically is saying is that for each item in this fruit basket, which is a collection of items, in this case it's a list, I want to execute all the lines of code within this scope. So if I have more lines of code in here, it's going to execute that as well, as long as it's indented in the scope. So let me put a new line in here, and then if I run that again, you'll see that this code is also executed each time the loop is executed. If I exit the scope and I print something else, this, and then I run it again, you'll see that this code is only executed once and not 3 times. That's because it's out of the scope of the loop. So again, the scope of the loop is determined by the indentation level here. And the name of the variable that you write here, it doesn't have to be fruit or item or whatever. It can be anything you want. For example, I could write x. And now this usage of fruit is invalid because I haven't declared it anywhere in my code. So I'll have to change that to x as well. So as you can see, this first part of the syntax is basically any kind of name you want it to be, but it's usually good practice to call it something that's descriptive of what item it is we're actually looping through. So in this case, it is a fruit, and I'm going to change it back to fruit. And what this loop does for us is that it goes through each item in this fruit basket. So it goes through 1, 2, 3 different items, and each time it will set the value of that item equal to this fruit variable so that we can access it in the scope. So the first time the fruit is going to be an apple, and then it's going to be a banana, and then it's going to be a blueberry. So this loop will execute in total 3 times, 1 for each item, and we can access the item by just referencing it by the variable name that we used here. And again, this can be anything. Sometimes when you do a loop, it's also useful to know the index of item that we're currently iterating on. While I'm iterating through this, I also want to know what is the index of this fruit in case I might want to use it for, you know, whatever reason I want. So when I iterate through the apple, I want to know that it's at index 0, and then the banana is at index 1. Currently, I have no way to know that. So for us to do that, we can actually use a built-in function called enumerate in Python, and we do it like this. So type the name of the function, it says enumerate, and then we'll wrap the fruit basket in that function. So I'll open my parentheses and then I'll put my list in there. And now I actually have 2 values when I iterate. So I actually get the index as well. And for the index, it's conventional to name it I. And now I have access to these 2 variables. And if I print them out, you'll see that now I get both the index and the fruit as I'm iterating through this list. So to do that, remember, you just need to use this enumerate function, and then you can wrap your list with this function. What if we don't care about a particular list and we just want to run a piece of code 10 times? We can use a for loop to do that as well. We'll just have to use this inbuilt range function. This is what the syntax for that looks like. So this is an example of using the range function, and by using this function, we can make this piece of code execute 10 times or any times you want according to the number you put into that function. So let's go into our editor and give that a try as well. And this is what the syntax looks like. For I in range 10, and then we'll print looping I times. And then I'll run that, and you can see that it prints this out. And it starts at 0, so when you loop in range 10, you actually get index being from 0 to 9, and 10 is actually not included. But these are 10 iterations, just because it counts 0. So remember, when you use this function, it starts at 0, and it is not inclusive of this number, but it will iterate 10 times. This range function is actually quite flexible, so if you mouse over it, you'll see the documentation, and if you look at the function signature there, it doesn't only just take the stop range, you can also use it with three different arguments, where you can specify what the start is, what the stop is, and what the step is. So let's just get hands-on with that to see what I mean. So instead of doing range 10, let's specify start of 1, and then a stop of 100, and then let me run that. And you can see that it goes all the way up to 99 now, because I've specified the end to be 100. But if I scroll all the way to the start, it doesn't start at 0 anymore. It starts at 1, because I've specified that as the start range. So obviously, if I start that at 50 and I make the end range 60, and then I run that, you can see that, yeah, it starts from 50 all the way up to 60. Well, 59. And you can also specify a step, which is how much this increases by each iteration of the loop. So if I do that and I run it, you see now it only hits the even numbers. So 50, 52, 54, and so on. This can also be a negative number. So if I want to loop backwards, I can start from 10 and then I want it to end at 0. I can also make this negative 1. And then when I run that, you could see that it's counting backwards. So yeah, you could see the range function is pretty useful, and it's just good to keep in mind if you want to run your loops with a fixed step. So we've just covered for loops, which is a useful tool for iterating through a list or a range of numbers. But there's another type of loop available in Python as well, and this is called a while loop. The difference is that instead of iterating for a fixed range, the while loop iterates based on some condition, and it will continue to iterate as long as that condition is true. For example, you might have heard the term game loop in reference to video games. It's the game code that runs in a loop as long as the player is still playing. Or if we're building an app, then this type of loop is useful for when we want the user's input. For example, we want the app to keep prompting the user for a valid number until we get a valid response. And if they don't give us that number or they give us something else, we can loop back to the beginning of the input flow to prompt them again. So here's an example of a while loop in Python. It looks like this. We use the keyword while, and then we follow it with an expression inside that scope. And as long as that expression evaluates to true, this code would just keep on executing. So I'm going to go to my editor and then show you how this works. So I have a while true, and this expression is pretty much rigged because it's always going to be true and it's never going to change. And then this loop will keep running pretty much forever because this condition never changes, and it's just going to keep doing this over and over again without stopping. So let's run this program. And as you can see, my terminal is just running this over and over again. I can keep scrolling up. It just keeps looping. So in this case, our program is actually stuck in an infinite loop, and it's just going to do this forever. If you get into a situation like this, it's usually a bug or it's usually by accident. So to break out of it in your terminal, you can just press Control C, and that should just force the program to terminate. But if you don't want to be stuck in an infinite loop, you can also terminate a loop from within using this break keyword. So back in our editor, let's try that out. I'm going to add this break keyword to my infinite loop here. And then when I run it, it's actually only going to run once, because as soon as it hits this, this loop is broken and it will sort of just go on to the next thing in our script, which there's nothing there right now. But if I put another print statement here and I run that, you'll see that the loop breaks out of this code scope, but it goes on to execute this one, which is out of scope of the loop. So this is pretty much how a loop works. It will keep doing this as long as this condition is true or until it hits a break statement. And when it does, it'll just continue on the rest of your code like normal. We can combine the break keyword with the other things we've learned so far as well to make the loop break only when certain conditions are met. For example, let's keep track of how many times this loop is run and then break on the fifth iteration. and the code will look something like this. You can pause the video and just take a while to look at this if you want to understand it a little bit further, but we're going to hop to our editor and just implement this to see how it works. So I'm going to start by having a variable called count, and I'll start it at 0. And each time I'm inside the loop, I'm going to increment count by 1. And then I'm going to make this print statement tell me how many times I've looped already. And if I run that so far, we get we are looping 1 times, and then it breaks. But I only want it to break on the 5th iteration, so now I can do this instead. And then when I run it, even though I'm using a while loop and the condition is still true, we can see that the break is enforced when the count reaches 5. So we only run this 5 times, and then we break out of the loop. Now, you might be wondering, why write it this way with a while loop when we can achieve the same thing with the for range loop that we learned about earlier? That's a good question, and I'll leave that up to you to decide. Another useful keyword to know is the continue keyword. So rather than breaking out of the loop entirely, this keyword would just tell Python to go back to the beginning of the loop and continue with the next iteration. So let's go back to our code and let's put in this continue statement. So I've put this one here after we've incremented the count, but before we do all of this stuff down here. So let's run that and see what it does. You'll see that I loop 1, 2, 4, and 5 times, but I skip number 3. So what's going on here? Well, when the loop is running, on the 3rd iteration, we get count plus 1, so now count is equal to 3. Because count is equal to 3, we enter this condition and we hit this continue keyword. And the continue keyword stops the iteration of this loop. It basically just cuts this execution short and none of this code is touched, and it goes back to the beginning of this loop and it starts again. That's why when count is equal to 3, we never reach this print statement and we never see that appear here. And then it just goes back, resumes counting at 4, and then the rest of the loop is executed all the way up to 5, where it does eventually break. So just to recap, the continue keyword will cause the loop to go back to the beginning of the iteration, and the break keyword will cause the loop to exit and move on to the next part of the execution in the script. These two keywords also work with the for loops we looked at earlier as well. So here's the exact same code written as a for loop instead of a while loop. And one last thing I want you to know about while loops is that this Boolean expression here is actually evaluated each time the loop is run. For example, right now we've hard-coded it to true, so it's never going to change, but we can actually write a logical condition in here as well. So I can write while count is less than 5 instead of having that true condition, and now I don't need this break statement anymore. And I'm going to get rid of this continue statement as well, just to make this clearer. Here, I'm saying that while the count is less than 5, I'm going to keep doing this, but if the count eventually becomes bigger than 5, then this will be false, and then this loop will just naturally exit, and I don't need to forcefully break out of it. And when we run that, the loop does execute 5 times, and so we can see that the loop continues executing until this statement is no longer true, and then it just stops and exits on its own. Now, finally, I just want to touch on something called list comprehensions, which is one of my favorite features in Python. List comprehensions are a bit of an advanced topic, and it's quite unique to Python. So we're not going to go too deep into this today, but I'll just provide a quick summary. Here's an example of what list comprehension looks like in case you ever see it in the wild. On the first line, I create a normal list, and it's that 2, 4, 6, 0, 1. And on the second line, this is where I use the list comprehension. So it looks like a normal list when I open the brackets, but instead of a list of items separated by commas, I actually have an expression, 2 times x for x in my list. So what you're looking at is actually a shortcut for looping through a list and then creating a new list out of that at the same time. And in this example, I'm creating a new list where each element is doubled from the original list. So in that shorthand one-liner statement, I'm looping through my original list of 2, 4, 6, 0, 1, and then I'm doubling each element, and then I'm returning a new list where each element is doubled. If we go into our editor and then we run that, we'll see that the new list that we get is 4, 8, 12, 0, 2, which is basically all the items in the first list doubled. Now, we don't strictly need to use all of that fancy list comprehension syntax to do this. In fact, you can achieve the same thing by just writing it out as a normal loop. But the list comprehension technique just makes it a little bit faster to write and also a little bit easier to read. Python is full of shortcuts like this, and these shortcuts are generally known as syntax sugar. So if you see the term syntax sugar out in the wild somewhere, then this is the kind of thing that it's referring to. Now let's do a quick coding exercise just to practice what you've learned with loops so far. For this exercise, I want you to print out this pattern like you see here in the terminal using a for loop or a while loop. There's several different ways to do this, but the important thing is to get the output like this showing up on your screen when you run the program. So if you want to do this exercise, then pause the video right now for a moment and try to figure out how you can do this. There's several different ways to do this, so see if you can find one that works for you. And then when you're done, resume it and you can see my solution. So for my solution, I'm actually going to use two loops. In this first loop, you can see that I'm iterating from 0 to 5. So I'm using this range function that we learned about earlier because I want 5 rows. But for each row, I also want a set of numbers to show up. And so to get this line to print out at each row, I'm going to use a second loop. And for this one, I'm going to use a range of I plus 1. So let's think through this. In this first iteration, I is equal to 0. So I plus 1 is equal to 1. Remember, range doesn't include the end number we put. Range 1 will actually just give us 0. So then the message would just be 0. And then we'll add that to the message. And you've already seen the operators. We can use this with a string, so we can modify a string like this. And at the end of this subloop, we would have built our message, and then we can print it. Now in the second iteration, I will be equal to 2. So this range will be equal to 3. So then we get 0, 1, 2, whatever. And then as you can see, each time we go through this, this range gets a little bit bigger, so the message gets a little bit longer. So that is one way you can do that. You might not have done it exactly this way, and there's a lot of different ways to do it, but as long as you manage to get the output showing up like this using loops, then you've pretty much learned how to use loops. So well done. I hope you feel comfortable using loops in Python and understand how you can use them to iterate through a collection of items or to repeat your code execution a certain number of times. See you in the next video, where we're going to talk about dictionaries in Python. This is another data structure, just like the list, but in my opinion, dictionaries are the most powerful Python data structure you ever learn. So be sure not to miss that.